Name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Christ is risen.
Yeah.
He is risen indeed. This is Timothy Flanders with the meaning of Catholic. Jesus is King. Yeah. Welcome once again to your Monday morning man show. It's the Terror of Demons morning show. Together with co-host Paleocrat and Jake Fowler. How y'all doing, brothers?
Morning,
doing good. Yeah.
Unfortunately, Kennedy Hall could not be with us. He had a sudden, was struck with the plague last night. So we had to quickly change the topic. We'll get the spicy SSPX topic next week, God willing. So this week, we'll be talking about the current news in the United States, which is the potential overturning of Roe versus Wade. So we'll get into that. And what is the action plan for Catholic men of God in this situation? In the next 60 days, potentially the decision will come out in June. So before we get into that, you know what? I don't think I had my liturgical calendar ready. No, I did not. But let's see what's on the docket this week. Yesterday was Mother's Day in the United States and many countries. So happy Mother's Day to all mothers. We love you, and may Mary, Our Lady, greatest of mothers, bless you and your children this month. It's the third Sunday after Easter. Today is St. Gregory of Nazianzen, great doctor of the church. We also have St. Damian of Molokai tomorrow on the new calendar, a wonderful saint, Belgian, who went all the way from Belgium all the way to Hawaii to minister on the leper colony of, I believe it's the island of Molokai. They had him all sequestered, and then he died of leprosy. So a great saint, died in 1889. We have the apostles, Philip and James, on Wednesday, and Our Lady of Fatima on Friday. So if you haven't already joined the novena for the overturning of Roe versus Wade, that's happening on day six today, I think. So check that out if you're not a part of it. We're doing it in the Fellowship of St. Anthony. We're doing it at 1 Peter 5. This week on Meaning of Catholic, we'll have, first of all, we have the St. Joseph Dialogos with Michael Lofton. That'll be later today at 1 p.m. Eastern Time. We're talking about something about the trad movement. I don't even remember what we're talking about. But so Michael Lofton, it'll be on Reason of Theology. Tune in later today. And then Paleocrat, you guys, are you broadcasting on Reason of Theology later today too?
Yeah. What time are you guys doing that? Is it every week now?
Well, it's going to be this Dialogo show is planning to be every month ahead of the first Wednesday for St. Joseph. But we had to reschedule from last week. So.
Oh, OK. Yeah. OK. Yeah, because I remember last week I had to be done by a certain time, I thought. So this week, yeah, I can do that again, too. That's perfectly fine. But yes, I am doing, yeah, every week, man. That's my show is on Mondays.
All right. So, Catholic presuppositionalism part four, I think, right?
This would be part six, and it's the introduction to Francis de Sales and his Catholic controversy.
Sweet.
And so we're going to introduce it, talk about the basic idea of how he uses that in his apologetic against Protestantism, and why he says that it is a method that can be used almost equally against all heresies. So any error you can do, it's kind of like St. Irenaeus, same thing. He's like, yeah, if you understand this method, you can use it against heretics everywhere. So it's going to be a lot of fun.
Yeah, this will be great. So check out, it's a very, very important show series from Paleocrat, the presuppositionalism critique of modern Catholic apologetics, restoring a more fundamental, foundational apologetic system. If I may say the S word to describe your thought, I don't know if system would.
System is the core of it.
Okay.
Yeah, it is. It is the core. Yeah.
Could you have a system to critique systems?
Yeah, that's what it is. It's systems analysis.
Systems analysis. Excellent. Yeah. Systems analysis. Excellent. Well, so this week on Meaning of Catholic, will God willing, I'm hoping to restart the weekly Spiritual Life show on Thursday. continue. Pope Benedict vindicates the trads on Friday. I'm hoping to have the guild stream about E. Michael Jones's article finally. Synodality's hidden ethnic grammar. That'll be on the guild stream. God willing, this Friday. My hope is to get it done. Then we could talk about E. Michael Jones. The guild stream is where we talk about all the controversial stuff, including E. Michael Jones, who's unfortunately persona non grata on every platform. So if you want to be part of the guild, get the guild content, the guild community, that's patreon.com/meetingofcatholic. And Jake, what's going on with the Jake Fowler files this week?
Right. Yeah. Hey, that's not a bad idea. I just call it that. Yeah. Well, part, I don't know, something teen coming up. I'm inching towards third Constantinople. And we took a look at a couple weeks ago, Honorius and Heraclius and everything like that. Last week was Martin the First, Pope and Martyr, St. Maximus. And so picking up in like the 660s and moving forward for third Constantinople, maybe we'll cover a little bit of the aftermath as well. But as I mentioned, you guys know this, you can't draw a hard and fast line between where one council ends and the other begins, right? It's just sort of the saga of the church, and for better or worse, that's the way it is. So any division that I, you know, like, and we'll stop here, that's just me, like, that's good for today, you know. But I think it's been going well. I'm getting a lot of positive feedback, and I'd like to do more, honestly. I'd like to do more of this kind of stuff. And I think in the summertime, once classes are over, then I'll be able to maybe put a little bit more effort into it. But nonetheless, that's what I've got going on this week. I think it's part 14.
Sweet.
Can I add one more thing?
Go ahead. Go ahead.
And kind of bouncing off what Jake just said, Jake and I collude in private, right? So we talk, we put our heads together on different ideas, and coming up with different plans for the summer to say, because we both agree more content, right? Like, but what kind? Like, is it live stuff? Is it pre-recorded stuff? Small videos, long videos? We have those kinds of conversations, and so there's going to be things coming out like that, even shorter videos and stuff on different topics. But also, I just want to throw this out there too. I hosted yesterday. We have a thing called the Luna Pack, and the Luna Pack is for the ladies, and your boy is not allowed in there. Normally, that's been the rule for a long time. Is even the Kaiser is not allowed in the Luna Pack. But I think that they've heard the call. They know that the ladies every once in a while would like to have a chat and have my wife and I together where we can go in there and talk. And we did one yesterday. And so I was invited in for that. So invited in. We talked about ideas. So I made it in, boys. I made it in. But the idea is simple, is that a lot of ladies, you know, they like the live chat. They like getting in on this stuff. But it's easy for guys to dominate where in the chat, you know, they get in there. It's all of a sudden, next thing you know, it's a bunch of dudes talking politics and philosophy and culture and theology and stuff. And they don't really, they want to say things, they enjoy listening, but sometimes it's just not their thing. And so you end up with these live chats just dominated by dudes. That's it. And so we talked about that, not just last night, but before. And I said, I want to do stuff for kids. I want to do things even where, like, readings, like book readings to kids, and things with families and more family oriented stuff that can be done, and to interview ladies and eventually just create it in a way that the Luna Pack can function as a part of Paleocrat Diaries, but where ladies in that chat can lead it too, and that they can lead conversations with each other, prayer groups with each other, things like that inside there, and have people from, you know, different lay apostolates that are focused mainly their attention on the role of women, or what women do, or how women contribute to this cause of restoring all things in Christ in the midst of a terrible crisis. And so we talked about that yesterday, and it was a bunch of fun. It was awesome. And so if you're interested in that sort of thing, you can either email me, paleocratdiaries@gmail.com, or if you're already on Telegram, just reach out to my wife. It's lovesick, L-U-V-S-I-C, me. That's all it is, just lovesick me. Or just look up Angela Bannister. You'll find her. Or look me up. It doesn't matter. Just connect with the Luna Pack. And make sure that you're there, because we're going to be doing awesome things in there for the ladies, and it's going to be a bunch of fun.
And I just want to remind everybody to check out Jake, because his series is so important, and you've already brought this out on a couple of your episodes, is it's so important for us to see this in the light of Vatican II. And we have this crisis after an ecumenical council, and a widespread crisis and loss of faith or bloodshed or all sorts of crazy nastiness after an ecumenical council is not that big of a deal, church history wise. I mean, it is a big deal, but we shouldn't be losing our faith if there's a crazy thing that happens after. I was just thinking of, because today we have St. Gregory of Nazianzen, and he was at the second ecumenical council, 381, which is really, 381 was really the only time when the Council of Nicaea was definitely, definitely a good, like, totally confirmed and kind of won the day, finally. And it wasn't entirely clear that it was going to win until about 381. So we've got about almost 60 years later, a constant bloodshed, armies, people being killed, people being murdered in mass, mobs, serious problems. This is,
but what, even then, but even then, Arians didn't go away. Arian bishops didn't go away. And in fact, St. Gregory at the council was, they played him because he comes into the council as Patriarch of Constantinople. And then the faction on the other side who didn't like him, they reminded him, weren't you the Bishop of Zazima, this backwater town in the middle of nowhere that, oh, by the way, you've never even been to your see. You don't even know what it looks like. You've never met a single person there. And, oh, doesn't Nicaea say that you can't move from see to see? Isn't that against canon law? And he just, he like leaves. He's like, fine, goodbye.
Yeah.
And so he's completely thwarted, but that's just standard affair for the councils. And so, you know, you hear people today talking about, oh, it's a failed council and why was it necessary? And okay, maybe you've got some interesting points to make. Probably not. We've heard it all before. But give this thing another 100 years and then see what you say. Because if you said, well, it's 335, there are still Arians, why was Nicaea necessary? Obviously, it's failed. Like, you've missed the point.
Right. What was it? There's this great quote, I think it's from St. Gregory Nazianzen, where he says, councils are full of evil, or something like that. I don't know if it was him or not, but one of these fathers, it may have been St. Gregory or St. Basil, where they say something like, ecumenical councils are always evil, something like that. And it's true. Like, there's pretty much every ecumenical council has a bunch of evil going on, either at the council or as an occasion of the council or whatever. The enemies of Christ always take occasion for an ecumenical council to try to go crazy or do something. So,
and this is a brilliant first topic for a Lunapack chat, I think. They would really like this.
Yeah, the Luna. Yeah, they love it. Yeah,
I should come in and give a guest lecture. That's what.
Dude, I've got you, bud. I've got you. I'll just say he's with me. All right. He's with me, ladies.
Yeah. But seriously, Lunapack will be girls only, boys not allowed.
You're only there by invite for that event. That's it. Other than that, you gotta go.
So let's get into our topic. If you haven't followed the news, huge. Breaking news, probably the biggest news in pro-life history since probably the Casey case in 1992. There was a leaked document this past Monday or Tuesday, which leaked the fact that there was an authentic majority opinion written, which indicates that the majority on the court intends to overturn Roe versus Wade in the Dobbs case. And this has been confirmed by the Supreme Court as an authentic leak. It's the real deal. So by all accounts, it does appear that the Supreme Court intends to overturn Roe versus Wade next month, which now it appears that it was leaked by some Marxist, probably, to try to provoke pressure on the court to not do that. There has now been leaked the personal addresses of various Supreme Court judges. So we've had protests at the Supreme Court from the Marxists. We've had protests at the Supreme Court's personal residences. We've had one particular group that got some news was this diabolical Marxist group called Ruth Sent Us. And they promised to disrupt the Holy Mass this Sunday as an attempt to attack Catholics. St. Thomas More Society sent them a legal warning and said that they would pursue legal action against them if they followed through with this threat. So it looks like I've been scouring Twitter and I don't see any Ruth Sent Us who successfully went through with that threat, except for at the old cathedral in New York City. That's the only protest that I've actually seen covered at all. You may have seen the video of.
Is it at St. Patrick's?
Yeah.
Old St. Patrick's.
Yeah. And that was Militant Thomist interviewed one of the guys who was praying and standing at the door.
Yeah. So there was one video of men of God standing against the Marxists there. Our security group at our parish was ready for them if they came to our church, but they didn't yesterday. So we're going to talk about some of the news and then talk about the Anti-R0e action plan. What are men of God to do? I want to first introduce and observe here that this is the interplay between logos on the one hand and voluntarism on the other. This is what I discuss in my book, City of God, which is the age-old battle between Satan and the city of man and the city of God, because the city of God works by means of logos, by means of law. I think this dichotomy between St. Thomas More Society and Ruth Sent Us is just a perfect example of that, because Ruth Sent Us is promising to do all these acts of voluntarism. Now, voluntarism is what that is just it means that the force of justice means might makes right. We're just going to force you to do something. We're going to bully you to do something. If we don't like what you're doing, we're going to beat you up and make you do it. It's the force of will, the triumph of the will. It is the truth is the opinion of the powerful. Justice is only a matter of the stronger overcoming the weaker. That's what voluntarism is. And that's how Satan works. And that's how all the enemies of Christ work throughout history. They always use voluntarism because they cannot use logos. They cannot use logos is the force of reason, the force of law, the force of a reasoned argument to convince someone with rationality. And so Ruth Sent Us promised a bunch of this violence or whatever to try to bully people. St. Thomas More Society, using the force of logos, said, we're going to take legal action on A, B, C, D, E, F, G. Here's all your evidence. Here's all your threats that you made. Here's what we'll do based on the legal means, rational means. And what happens when logos actually faces voluntarism? Voluntarism always loses, because voluntarism is weaker than logos. Logos always wins. So all that is necessary here in this whole battle is for men of God to fight against the voluntarism of the mob by means of logos. And so I want to first talk generally about this and also point out the uncomfortable truth that the founding of the United States is a mixture of logos and voluntarism.
Right.
It's a very, very strong mixture of oil and water in the founding of the United States, because there was a great deal of mob violence from the heroes, so-called, of the American Revolution, which founded the United States in 1776. For example, especially the Sons of Liberty, the Sam Adams in Boston, there's a lot of mob violence, a lot of anti-Catholic rhetoric that stirred up the mob. And then we have the imposition of the Constitution, which I would consider an act of tyranny, in my opinion. Which then imposed on the 13 colonies a new set of laws imposed on them. And then we have the usurpation of the Supreme Court, because now, because of the system in the United States, we don't have a harmony of hierarchy. We have a so-called balance of power, which is where all these powers just fight against each other.
And that's we're seeing this big time right now.
So, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you see this with what was it? Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer, right?
Exactly.
March 2020, that quote, you know.
Yeah, let me just bring that up real quick here. Yeah. So basically, when Gorsuch, this was against Gorsuch. So this is a good summary here from LifeSite. And this goes back to, some have recalled the comments of Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer made in March 2020 on the steps of the Supreme Court. He says, quote, "I want to tell you, Gorsuch, I want to tell you, Kavanaugh, you have released the whirlwind and you will pay the price. You won't know what hit you if you go forward with these awful decisions." Voluntarism. This is how they work. They can't make a legal argument. They can't make a rational argument. They use violence. That's what the Mohammedans do. That's what any enemies of Christ do. It's the only thing they can do is try to use force.
Man, Tim, when you said that, it's like the whirlwind. I know this is kind of silly, but it was the first thing that came to my mind. So here's one of the books that I used to prep for my show. I don't know if you all could see that.
Oh, here, let me switch back to
The Building of Christendom by Warren Carroll.
Yes.
This is volume two. He's got a 6-volume set. There are some deficiencies, perhaps. Maybe he's a little too triumphalistic, ignores some of the bad things that he could have brought out a little more fully. Nonetheless, in his chapter on the rise of Islam, he calls it the red whirlwind from the desert. And so it just, I don't know, it's kind of silly, but seeing that in Schumer's language and in Carroll's language, and Muslims are voluntarists and the leftists are obviously voluntarists, that just stood out to me as instantly, that's a red flag. That's not a good thing, right?
Right. That's what we saw when, as you went out with Regensburg, Pope Benedict makes a speech, which is talking about it's all about logos and voluntarism. The whole speech is about logos and voluntarism. And what happened? The Mohammedans immediately proved his point by rioting throughout the world.
That's
exactly what they do. So the Mohammedans, various Jewish sects, we've got the Marxists, Masons, whatever. All they do is use voluntarism. They use violence. They use lies and deceit, propaganda. That's all they can do. And so all we need are men of God who are willing to stand up against these forces of voluntarism by means of logos, specifically logos incarnate, Jesus Christ himself.
Right.
Paleocrat, you have any thoughts?
Well, I was going to say, first of all, before we get, too much hatred from everybody. Oh, no.
Too late. No, you're good.
Okay. I was like, did everybody go?
We're gone. Tim and I are gone.
You're like, Paleocrat, anything you'd like to contribute? And then it's like, zoinks on me. So, I just wanted to say that some people would say, well, I thought voluntarism is the principle of relying on voluntary action, just used especially with reference to the involvement of voluntary organizations in social welfare. If that's your standard, though, right? If that's your standard, you just have a competing faction and competing faction. And so, if you're not, if the core principle isn't one of authority and hierarchy, things like that, authority properly designed and understanding the nature of how authority works, which the church has written about extensively, then it falls prey, of course, to the underlying philosophy of this, and that is the doctrine that the will is the fundamental or dominant factor, not only in the individual, but also in the universe. And that's where you would have the will to power, for example. That's where you would have what happens if competing factions driven by their will, unless they agree on some core proposition, a set of core propositions. But if they don't, that's what they're competing about. And so if you don't have that, then you're going to be left with, ultimately questions on where's the line of fanaticism end? Where does the line of driving that point home and revolutionary actions, oftentimes by the left, just simply called direct action. And you can have direct action on either side, the right or the left. But in political activism, in the life of political activism, it typically ends up resulting in community organization, which again is, as we understand it, an Alinskyite idea, is a distortion, right? So you can say, social action, social justice, community organizing, all of those things can be framed in something that's good if, in fact, it is lawful. By lawful, I mean that the idea of law, order, hierarchy, structure, proper concept of authority is understood. If it is not, and it is simply an expression of an individual or group's will to power, Yeah. That's when you're entering crazy town, and that's when you're going to start having these threats of violence all over the place, because that's the only way that they're going to attain that. If they can't convince you with an argument, or accept the slow roll of incrementalism, it might be time to, to pull it. Maxine Waters, which she said to people about, if you see them in the streets, if you see them at the gas station, you tell them they're not welcome here, kind of thing, or Gorsuch being threatened, you played the wrong move. You're going to have people coming against you. You don't even know what you've unleashed now. And it's like, wow. So you start, it's kind of like one of those offers you simply can't deny sort of things, like, hey, volunteerism, like, dude, you want to voluntarily get in on this? And you're like,
right.
That's where I think that happens.
And yeah. I think it's so pernicious too, because when you have this normal discourse, let's say in America or in whatever other Western nation, you're presupposing that the other side agrees to your system, your structure of the rule of law, the court system. Your people are elected. Now you get to make the rules. Now my people are elected. Now we get to make the rules. And it's all a front for the left. It is simply, when things are going their way, yeah, sure, rule of law, courts, elected representatives. But if we don't like something, we're coming to your house and we're bringing the mob, right? Mm-hmm. So it's a complete farce, and it breaks down. And this is, I think that's why it's so pernicious, because people look at this and they're like, oh my gosh, the people, this is the will of the people. You're like, no, this is the will of about 5% of the radicals who have a lot of noise.
And I want to emphasize too, that even if it was the will of the people, if it's not according to Logos, it's still mob rule. So yeah, right. You could have a democratic, this is the problem, even with the leaked opinion. So the leaked opinion basically says Roe versus Wade was a usurpation of the Constitution. We need to allow states to decide it. Well, that's also an error, because truth is not determined by majority vote. Truth is truth. It can be ascertained by means of reason. But if we have voluntarism, we just have every contract and every interaction and every governmental, whether that's a economic contract between two individuals, two parties, or some kind of government social contract between peoples. If Logos is not involved, it's all devolves into this voluntarism, just marriage. The power of the wills fighting with each other.
Yeah. Marriages. Mm-hmm. Same thing. I mean, yeah. So if it's just a contract between two people, right? Like the individual, it's just a matter of will, and how that kind of ebbs and flows and everything else. And so, yeah, if you take the core out of that, if you take your most ruling and operative assumptions out of that, being order, law, God, right? Natural law, things like that. Yeah. You're toast. You're now left with just this kind of animalistic grouping. These various groups that come together in group dynamics, and that's a fancy way of saying, balkanization. You're balkanized, good for you. You need the Lord.
And so what I talk about in my book, City of God versus City of Man, this is in many ways the manifesto of this apostolate with Terror of Demons by Kennedy Hall, is that in the formation of Christendom, we have the formation of society according to Logos, which takes all of these warring parties and gradually converts them to a system of social and political thought and livelihood according to Logos, which actually ends war and diminishes conflict and frees the slaves, et cetera, et cetera. But then we have, especially what we observe, is that with the heretical Anglican regime in the 1500s, we have a voluntarism-based society where we have the King Henry VIII and Parliament both agree to reject Rome and reject Logos. So they set their society up as a voluntarist society. But we have these two different powers, Parliament and King, who are both absolute tyrannies, but they agree on their enemy. But what happens with that is that if we start to found society based on this voluntarist idea, it's just a power of the will against Rome, it leads to civil war. And that's exactly what happened within 100 years in the English Civil War in the 1640s, later leading to the so-called Glorious Revolution. We call it in the book, the Ugly Revolution, 1688, which is where they forced out the Catholic king and put on the throne King William. And this is what provoked John Locke to write his second treatise on government, which inspired the American Revolution later. But we have the exact same thing playing out in the United States history, because we have this strong voluntarism at the founding of the United States, which leads eventually to a civil war within 100 years. Exactly same thing played out, same principles, exactly the same thing happens. I wanted to quickly go through a little bit of the Supreme Court. And this is from a video we did with the Gordon brothers a while back. This was back when Trump was appointing the justices. I think this was when, I can't remember which justice we were. I think it was Amy Coney Barrett when we did this show. But anyhow, we've got this show. You can look at this. So this is a little bit of the history. So the usurpation of the Supreme Court with this so-called balance of power, where the Supreme Court begins to take greater power in these United States. So in these United States, we've got, if you're not a citizen of these United States, there's these three different branches: executive, which is the president, Supreme Court, judicial, and then we also have Congress and the legislative branch, which makes laws. There's supposed to be a balance of power, but they just fight with each other because there's no principle of logos. It's principle of voluntarism. So in 1803, the first case was decided where the Supreme Court gave itself jurisdiction to strike down laws which it considered to violate the Constitution, 1803, which is interesting because it's already rewriting the Constitution, so-called, in 1803. So we got the problems going back to 1803. Then we have the famous Dred Scott decision, 1857. This is where the Supreme Court ruled that Black Americans are not American citizens, including free Blacks. That's what the Constitution says, according to the Supreme Court. And then we have the famous Plessy versus Ferguson, 1896, which is where the court ruled that racial segregation is separate but equal, which that was overruled in 1954, Brown versus Board of Education. But then in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, we have this sexual revolution imposed by the Supreme Court. So 1957, Roth versus U.S. This is the court, which is the Supreme Court legalizes evil images, pornography. Before this, the Catholic Church had been pressuring Hollywood to make clean movies. Well, that was undone by the Supreme Court. And then we have 62, Engel versus Vitale. Court rules that school prayer is unconstitutional. 64, court helps continue to legalize pornography. 65, court says Constitution protects contraception. All of this is the backstory to Roe versus Wade. We wouldn't have Roe versus Wade if we didn't legalize pornography, legalize contraception, destroy school prayer, all of this stuff. And it's all coming from the Supreme Court, which had expanded its own powers since 1803. So we've got bigger problems and bigger fish to fry. And if we don't see the bigger problem with a lack of Christendom, a lack of logos, we're not going to be able to truly fight against Roe versus Wade, which is just sort of the surface level problem, which is going to go deeper. Any comments, gentlemen?
Yeah, I think seeing you walk through all these court decisions just kind of reconfirms what we were saying earlier about the pernicious nature of this voluntarism, because it hides, right? The first couple, well, aside from the first one, but the ones about race and racial segregation and you know, the status of Black Americans, those were obviously good decisions that the Supreme were like, no, you can't say that racial segregation is okay, and no, you can't deny people the right to. Okay, so it can be used for good, right? But then a little while later, it's like, no. Well, here we go with the evil images and the contraception, and then in 73, abortion. So it's the same system, though. So how could it produce good and bad at the same time, right? And there, you know, 2015, Obergefell v. Hodges, right? The marriage debacle, the utter disaster. And that's because they don't have Christendom, like you said, but they don't have logos. They don't have the rule of law. And they don't have the rule of divine law, I should say. They appear to have the rule of human law. And that's how these things are able to be successful. But it's I don't want to call it a slippery slope. I don't think that's it. But maybe it's just unknown. It's hidden. It's the guy behind the guy, you know. So Roe is a problem, naturally. But until the thing that gave us Roe is corrected, right? I think that's kind of the direction you're leaning, Tim, is until the root here, which is the lack of Christ, until that's corrected, what's going to be next? We don't know.
So we got 15 more minutes. I want to just talk practically speaking. What do we actually do? What's the action plan? And I have four or five thoughts, and I'd like your thoughts, y'all, on what do we actually do here? First, I think that all men of God need to add some daily Marian devotion to beseech the Mother of God to overturn Roe versus Wade, to see this decision through. If you already pray five decades of the rosary, why not add five more? Pray 10 decades of the rosary. Pray a full rosary, which is 15 decades, the full Mary's Psalter every day. Pray the Septuum Presidium, the Memorare. Add a little prayer every single day. Add something to your daily routine, beseeching Our Lady to intervene. Number two, now is the time to fight like Christian men, which means forgiving your enemies, not succumbing to voluntarism yourself, because the Marxists are going to throw everything at you, and you have to be able to forgive your enemies. And this is what converted. This is the stories of the martyrs, where the martyrs go up against the Roman governor and they convert the Roman governor. They convert these pagans because they see how strong they are in Christ and how they are completely unwilling to pinch incest to Caesar, but they're also completely unwilling to hate their enemies. So we need to have this Christian charity. Number three, I think once we have the primacy of prayer and the primacy of grace, because this is the most important, we can't do anything without grace. We can't do anything without maintaining our spiritual life, maintaining our state of grace. Once we do that, then we need to have a new 40 days for life outside the Supreme Court, 40-day, 60-day constant vigil. As we do as Catholics throughout the United States. We do this at the abortion mills throughout the United States. I think we need to go to the Supreme Court justices' addresses, do vigil there, because I would just heard this, and I don't know much about the history, but Brian McCall over at CFN just mentioned last week that the original Roe versus Wade decision in 1973 there was some kind of political pressure put on the justices. Because initially they were going to either rule against it or throw it out or something. And then they put a lot of political pressure on the justices, which successfully won them over. So the justices may be reversed by this voluntarist action by the Marxists. So, but if we have people who are doing a vigil at these residences against the Marxists in favor of the rule of law, maybe that will show the justices that we have your back and we're going to fight for you, or we're going to defend you against the pillories and calumnies that the Marxists will throw at you. Now, if you can't go to, you know, if you can't go to Washington, D.C., here's number four. If you can't go to Virginia, Maryland, wherever they live, how about this? Number four is each one of us takes on some sacrifice until Roe versus Wade is overturned. So what I mean by this is people give up things for Lent. Give up something right now until Roe versus, just forever, until Roe versus Wade is overturned. as a spiritual action, beseeching the Lord to overturn it. So you really love pizza. Give up pizza for the rest of your life until Roe versus Wade is overturned. You really like chocolate. You really like whatever. You really like your favorite TV series. Or you really like Netflix. Give up Netflix. It could be something actually spiritually helpful to you as well. Especially as some kind of sacrifice that you can just give up until Roe versus Wade is overturned. And then five is more general. Get politically active with your own representative, because the other things that the Marxists want to do is that they want to try to pass legislation in the United States Congress, in the Senate, in Washington, D.C., to make a federal law that abortion is legal. Because right now there's not a federal law of that. It's based on this court precedent in 1973. So getting involved with your local representatives who are in Washington, D.C., to try to influence them as much as you can, getting more politically active as well. So those are my five anti-Roe action plan.
What
do y'all think?
I'm skeptical of going to their homes. And in part because number one, the way to do that is to know where they live. And one of the criticisms that we talk about, even in the LifeSite article you referenced earlier, was that a left-wing activist had published their addresses to have people go to their homes, in front of their homes, and to do this. And I think that especially if the other people are there, our presence is actually worse. We would do better maybe to, I'll say this. I turned off the camera for a second because I'm talking about this today. This is the book I'm talking about today on the show. Okay, Catholic Controversy. But in here, it was talking about Francis de Sales. He had planned to take Geneva by love. Quote, love will shake the walls of Geneva. Ardent prayer must break down the walls of Geneva. Brotherly love to charge them. Everything gives way to love. He says it would be by penance that we would do it. Invoking the guardian angel of the diocese is how he did it. Pray the rosary daily. His apostolic use of intelligence, perseverance, and personal contact was another one. And then it talked about like going to the everyday people, the chit chat. You'd go to the peasants. And so you'd go to other people that you know, talk to other people that you know, might be an example. Having mass, of course, mass, but also, and it's interesting you brought up the 40 days. He had here, one of the things in the area that was brand new, was he organized a 40-hour devotion, 40 hours of continual solemn exposition of the sacrament accompanied by constant prayer. This was then a new devotion that wasn't widespread. There was also a procession. The procession began with 500 people, and it moved 18 miles to the town of Animas, where the devotion would be held. Many more people joined, into the point where by the end they estimate there was about 30,000. So it started with 500 people, this procession. And so I think that I bring this up because sometimes that idea that we go right to their homes, their private homes, that's one of the criticisms we have against voluntarism, and that it turns into this mob thing. If no matter where I was, even if I sided with somebody, if all of a sudden there was a huge group of people outside and it was a bunch of crazy loonbirds back, you know, knocking on pots and pans and bells and screaming in microphones and all that, which they've done before, and it ends up looking bad on them every time. It does not look good on them that they do that. But if I knew that there was also a big gaggle of people on the opposite side, and it was over an issue as volatile as this, that's gangs in New York about to happen in front of my home. And that would be one of those things that seems like it'd be ripe for being volatile. Like it's a volatile situation. So I would say, why not rather do things like processions, for example, where you got large numbers of people, orderly structured, Christ at the center, leading the way with song, and that it's made very clear what it's about. And that your spokespeople, when you talk to the media and you do press releases, that it's very specific, that it is in support of those who would be taking a strong stand against the murder of children, that would be a more orderly way of doing it, still in a group structure, separate from a volatile situation, abstaining from anything that would be thrown at us, like, dude, you're in front of my house trying to pressure me to do these things and everything, that I think that is at least worthy of consideration, that conversation. That's the only thing.
That's really good. I mean, if anybody's in Washington, D.C. area and wants to help coordinate something like this, contact me. I'll be putting out this at 1Peter5 as well. I'm going to look up all my contacts as much as we can to do something like this. And I like what you're saying, Paleocrat, because, yeah, you're right. I mean, we don't want to give the impression that we're just another mob. We want to give the impression that we are pious Catholics who are acting according to Logos, as we've said. So,
especially because you can't, when you get people there, you can't control it. So, like, you get there, right, and you're going to have people with megaphones. You're going to have people saying some of the darndest things, right, that are just going to be like, whoa, dude, I don't support that guy. But that's going to be the reflection.
Right.
That's going to be what, of course, the media is going to use that. I mean, that's going to be what they've used.
It's so, definitely an issue of organization that needs to be properly organized so that it is orderly, as you said.
Let them quote the written prayers that we do, and let them quote the songs that those little girls are singing as they're throwing flower petals on the sidewalk.
There we go. Jake, what are your thoughts?
In addition to what you guys have said, I would add, inform yourself. And not just abortion is bad, right? That's obvious. Yeah. But get down into the weeds a little bit, according to your ability, about why is abortion bad. And don't just settle for some of the more obvious reasons. Because as we move forward as a society, whether we're looking at a few months, a few years, for the rest of our lives, for that matter, people will challenge us on this. And if we can articulate a healthy, reasoned, right, Logos inspired response that doesn't devolve into, well, abortion is bad because think of the children. Okay, that's an appeal to emotion that, although it is on the correct side of things, it doesn't convince someone who's like, yeah, I don't care. Not that Logos always convinces people, but I think for those who are on the fence, those who aren't really sure what they believe and they don't really understand why they think what they think, and maybe, well, I don't like it in this situation, but maybe I'm okay with it in that situation, to have an arsenal of reasons and explanations why abortion is the scourge of the earth, that would help, right? And then don't be afraid, once you've informed yourself, don't be afraid to talk to others about it. Right. Go to those people, your friends and family. And if the occasion arises, don't be shy. Right. How many times have we perhaps passed up an opportunity because, well, I don't want to cause problems. I don't want to start a fight. You know, I don't even know what to say. Okay. So once you've prepared yourself with what to say and how to encounter various difficulties, then go do that. Go be a pro-life evangelist. Right. Not that you need to get a bullhorn and go to the sidewalk, but at work, for example, if somebody says, oh, my goodness, the Supreme Court's coming after all these women, you're like, wait a minute, hang on. No, actually, that's not necessarily the case. And let me explain to you why. So inform yourself, talk to others. And then last, this is sort of more at the local level, more practically speaking. Make sure you coordinate with other men at your parish, especially your pastor, to have a plan for when people come to your door, right? This past weekend, we should not delude ourselves. The threats were not simply for May 8th. It was ongoing. And I remember seeing, I think it was on, I don't have Twitter, but I saw a screenshot of, I believe it was Anthony Stein's Twitter, and he was showing a photo from this Ruth Sent Us organization where they declared one of their intentions, at least, is to steal the Blessed Sacrament and burn it in a protest against the Catholic Church. So just because it maybe wasn't successful yesterday doesn't mean they're just going to be like, oh, well, we tried, whatever. That's not the way these folks are. So if you don't have a security plan at your parish, get one. If you don't have a core group of guys who know what to do and how to handle various situations, find them, right? I think I could probably say most American parishes have a policeman who attends. I don't think that's too much of a stretch. I would bet almost every American parish has someone in law enforcement or military background who can coordinate. Okay, here is how you safely protect people while you usher out violent protesters. Here is how you, you know, all these kind of considerations that maybe it sounds extreme, right? I don't want to be the guy who's like, oh no, doomsday scenario. But let's be honest, things can go south really quickly. Right. And I was a policeman for about 8 years, and situations escalate in ways that you don't expect. So you have to be prepared for the things you can't prepare for. And the only way to do that is to have those conversations with the men at your parish, with the pastor, and ultimately with your families to make sure that if the worst happens, you know what to do.
Absolutely. Great, great points. Great additions. Thanks, Jack. Jeremiah, you want to say one more thing and we'll close out. Go ahead.
Yeah, there was, I don't know how many people remember this, but back in 2020, there were a collection of groups led by Black Lives Matter, Shutdown DC, and others who for months had been privately on Zoom, had been talking and coordinating, collaborating with each other on how to shut down DC. It had gotten to the point where anyone who studies like radical activism and stuff and reports on it would recognize a lot of the people in there. And some of those are, you know, seasoned veterans of this crazy left-wing violent kind of direct action. And talking about even the possibility that gunshots would be fired and the people might die and stuff like that. And talking about taking over certain buildings and understanding where, how to get into the buildings. They had the maps on there. They had all this. And there were video. There was leaked video from this. People were recording it and sending it out. And the thing is, they had people from all different levels of government in there who were part of that, who had jobs that gave insider information regarding infrastructure, stuff like that. My point is that sometimes we think that a lot of the left-wing activism is just people getting together in a small little place. That does happen. But there's also stuff like that where it you may think something's not as highly coordinated as it is, but it is. And they anticipate our moves. In fact, they incorporate our potential moves into decisions that they make. I used to cover this sort of thing and have interviewed even different Occupy groups and stuff like that over the years, Antifa groups and everything. And the kind of coordination that they have, the kind of retreats that they do, the camps that they have where they spend an entire week and have speakers come in and they network together at night and stuff like that. It's quite elaborate, in fact, and they mean business. And one of the things, the last thing about it is that one of those things that they do, and I warned people about this about January 6th when it went on. I was one of those people that was telling people it was inadvisable to go. You have your right to go, but this is how it's going to be used. This is how it plans to be used. This is what you should expect. And it's one of the reasons somebody mentioned in the comments here, if you go, Richard said, if you go to someone's house in the U.S., Homeland Security will have you on their domestic terrorist list. The FBI came to my house. Over January 6th. And there was some radical activist, some rando Annan said, I think that's paleocrat, which is a little flattering in a way that somebody thought, you know, like they knew me enough that they were like, oh, I think that's that guy, you know, but I was not there. The FBI knew I was not there. They'd been monitoring my stuff for a while. They knew all about these stories and I was somebody telling people not to go. And so if you go, like if you're somebody saying don't go, it's verifiable they didn't go and you're still on that radar. That's what I'm saying. That's why I'm like, people don't, there's a lot of people, oh, that's fine with me. You better come and check me out, blah, blah, blah. Well, you're also hearing, you know, those audio tapes of people in indefinite detention singing patriotic songs and never knowing when they're going to get out. You know, you don't want to be that guy. And so you got to think smarter. You got to do better and you got to know what's going to help and what's not and how that can be used against our group in the long run. Everybody had a right to be there. They had that's a right. According to our constitution, they had a right to support their candidate. They had a right to do a whole bunch of stuff, but that's not always the issue. Sometimes the issue is how can what people do with what their rights are? How can people use that in a way even against you? And to say that ended up, it's like one of those, I can, but ought I questions. And I think that those kind of considerations are mature. It requires a collection of people who are on the same page about the lawfulness of our order, about the idea that we come together and we subject ourselves to Christ and we think ahead, not just this immediate knee-jerk thing, but that we have serious plans. We really think these things through in an orderly fashion, anticipating moves of the enemy, and doing better. And so I would just encourage that, people.
Very, very good. Yeah, that's excellent. Elaine points out, any action in D.C. would be used as another January 6th incident. Great point. Sursum Corda says, NCCB exists to be a force of logos in D.C. Is the NCCB used to be what the USCCB is called? What organization are you referring to? Do you all know what he's talking about?
I think that's what they meant.
Did you mean the USCCB, Sursum Corda? I don't know if you did or not, but you can tell us in the chat.
He's talking about the Network Consolidated Cooperative Bank.
I would not really put any faith in very few bishops in the United States to take any solid action. I mean, March for Life, 40 Days for Life, these are all lay-led organizations that have very little bishop involvement. The bishops just kind of keep it at arm's length. Unfortunately, there's just not, it has to come for the laity unless some bishop has a conversion. I would welcome that, of course. But
Flanders is convincing me on this topic behind the scenes.
anyhow, let's offer up a Hail Mary to Our Lady to close this out. What we do always will be pleasing to the Lord according to His will, not our own. And we pray for the conversion, especially to Our Lady, the conversion of evil hearts, the softening of evil hearts, and the conversion and repentance of our enemies, the forgiveness of our enemies. So, Jeremiah, be my wingman again here.
Yeah, I didn't have it unmuted. I thought you were going to unmute me last time.
No, I think you got to unmute yourself. Anyways, let's pray.
I'll unmute myself. In
the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. Blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Our Lady of Victory,
pray for us.
Saint Joseph, terror of demons,
pray for us.
In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Christ is risen.
Yeah.